to do that. But our next guest, we want to welcome, he's the founder of WearWorks, Keith Kirkland. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me.
Okay, so you're going to have to tell us a little bit about this.
Yeah, we don't know anything.
So WearWorks is a company that builds products and experiences that communicate information through touch. And our first product, Wayband, mm-hmm. is a wearable haptic navigation device for the blind or visually impaired. Haptic just means of or relating to the sense of touch. Mm-hmm. And we used this technology back in 2017 to help a person who was blind run the first 15 miles of the New York City Marathon without sighted assistance.
Whoa. And why 17 and not the whole thing?
Oh, because it poured down raining, and all the things that we planned for, rain was not one of them.
That is how life works.
What that is how life works. We always want to know all the info, right? That thought was on your mind, right?
Of course.
So you're trying to make things more accessible for people who are visually impaired. So does this product help them navigate around structures, crowds? Like, how does it work in practice?
Yeah, and so actually the way it works is, if you look at it, there's two types of navigation. There's micro scale navigation, which helps you to avoid chairs, fire hydrants, and people. And then you have macro scale navigation, which kind of helps you find your way to the new coffee shop that you're meeting a friend at.
Got it.
And okay. So
it's like small stuff versus big stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Or kind of like local to you versus like larger scale. And what we're doing is we're not supporting with obstacle avoidance. We started down that path initially. Yeah. And when we brought the technology, they were like, you know, we have dogs, we have canes. We've been avoiding stuff for hundreds of years. Mm-hmm. Like, this part we figured out. This other part is a much bigger problem if you can solve this.
Interesting. So the dogs, the canes can help with the obstacle avoidance.
Exactly.
The macro stuff is kind of the whole thing.
Exactly. Because like when a person who's blind goes outside of their house to a new location for the first time, they have to do a lot of research to understand exactly where they're going, to format like where they are in space. And, you know, like, it's really, really time consuming and really mentally exhausting. And so what we're hoping to do is to give them that same freedom of like, get up and go to a new place by walking through the city and getting that navigation information that we all get visually through the sense of touch.
Have you ever seen Laura on the train seeing iDog say it's time to get off? They're really smart. They know the stop a lot of times. Have you seen that before?
No, I haven't.
Yeah, I've seen that before. And it was written about in the Post and the Times, and it's something that's very common.
But so how did you end up specifically working with visually disabled people?
Yeah, and so like when we started this company, it's like me and I have two co-founders. We all kind of came into this idea of haptics through different doors. My personal door I came through was that I had spent a year trying to build this suit as part of a thesis project that would allow a person to download Kung Fu, and the suit would teach them Kung Fu using vibrations.
That's amazing.
And so I
think you would have a lot of people who would buy that.
Can you imagine? Like,
and so the idea was that, you know, we would build this suit out and we would give you vibrational commands, and we would be able to expand a movement professional's ability in the same way that a phonograph did for musicians when it was invented. But one of the challenges that we ran into really quickly was that, because all the technology to build this was already existing, and we're like, why has no one done this? And then we realized why, because if I want you to raise your wrist 2 inches off of your lap using vibration, how do I tell you to do that?
Yeah.
There was no...
That's a communication issue.
There was no language of touch to communicate information with. But, you know, like, we kind of all use touch to communicate information in a regular on a daily basis. And so we're kind of like, how can we take these cues that we use culturally, you know, to communicate different things through touch and like transition them into like an intuitive like device or experience that people can just figure out which way is the right way to go without having to learn buzz, 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 buzz.
Yeah,
eventually means like stop.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So what's fascinating is did you have any connection to the visually impaired community?
No, personally, I didn't actually.
Because these communities are very vibrant. I worked a lot with the hearing impaired community in Texas when I was a reporter there.
Yeah. Interesting.
And they're very vibrant, very connected, fun, actually.
Yeah. And so my co-founder, Kevin, the door that he walked in was like he had met one of our blind advisors, and he was a public speaker and an author, and he was giving a talk at Pratt. And so he met him there and got really interested in the possibilities of using haptics to help the blind and visually impaired group. So for me though, like when it really came to us, we were at South by Southwest together. It was about 6 months after we had started, you know, of course we're in Texas, and you know, like a guy who we randomly pull out of the crowd to see if they can figure out which way is the right way to go without any instructions. And we tried this experiment on like hundreds of people, and most people get it in about 10 seconds, mm-hmm. right? And so this guy pulls out of the crowd, he tries it, he gets it in about 10 seconds, and then he says, holy crap, I'm a teacher for the Texas School for the Blind and Visually Impaired. You need to take this to the school like right now.
Wow. That's an incredible story.
Exactly, exactly. And so that's what we did. We broke everything down from South by Southwest, and we ran over because we only had about 5 hours left in town. And so we ran over to the blind school, and they were like totally closed because it was spring break, you know, like, but the superintendent was there, and he pointed us to the Texas Department for Blind Services, which was right around the corner. And we walked in and we met some people in a parking lot and was like, hey, we have a device that might be good for blind and visually impaired people. They were like, go talk to someone at the front desk. And then someone at the table was like, wait, what is this device that you have? And when we showed them, we had them spin around because we give them the device, we put it on their wrist, and we say, hey, spin around. And they do a 360 spin, usually like Michael Jackson, and then I tell them to spin slower. And then I say, okay, now stop, spin again and stop in a direction that you believe the device is telling you is the right way to go.
Yeah.
And most people, and so the people at the table, they figured it out, and they were like, okay, you need to speak with the assistant commissioner. His office is like 306B, like, and so we walk into his office, and we basically get like, unannounced, a 4-hour audience with him. He lets us borrow his office space. We borrow some of his employees who were blind. We interview them with the device on and get their experiences of being blind. And when we walked out of that initial meeting, it was just kind of clear to all of us that like, okay, like we have to do it for blind people first. You know?
How does the Wayband, so how does it work?
Oh, so it's a wrist wearable device.
Yeah.
You put it on your wrist and you pair it with an app that we've built, which is a mapping application. And you tell it where you want to go. Mm-hmm. It works really well. Right now, it's only on iOS, but it works really well with Apple's voiceover feature, which is what most blind people use to use their iPhones.
So they don't need help inputting the original.
No, no, exactly. Not at all.
And when will this be available to everyone?
So we're actually launching our Kickstarter in October. So it'll be available in about a month and a half.
Wow. Oh, great. What a fascinating
story. It's incredible, but it's such an opportunity, and it's so helpful to so many people.
Yeah, Keith, I'll be reaching out for other media opportunities because this definitely deserves more attention.
Yeah, thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Yeah, so Keith Kirkland, thanks for taking the time to be here with us.
Thank you so much for having me.
Good luck.
Thank you.